So my name's Zach. I'm with the company AQUALAB, or the brand AQUALAB. We make water activity devices. We've been doing this for like 40 years. I work as a food scientist, but also work with the sales team. So today I have a device here. It's called the AQUALAB 4TE. Does anyone here measure water activity?
With that.
Yeah, with this? Okay, great. You should be nice and familiar with it. So basically, water activity is something that some people in the pet food industry use, but I still see a lot of companies not using this measurement yet, because a lot of companies are familiar with moisture content. So moisture content is a quantitative amount of water. And a lot of companies that we work with are always trying to maximize their yield and their revenue. So the more water that's in your product, water's the cheapest ingredient in that formulation. And so companies are always trying to have as much water in products as possible, but they turn to moisture content because it's something that they're familiar with when they should really be using water activity. So water activity is something that we can measure with an extremely high degree of precision and accuracy using a device like this one. So this one is called an AQUALAB 4TE. Basically, this device takes maybe 3 to 5 minutes to get a water activity reading. And that reading that you get can be as close as plus or minus 0.005. So it's really precise, really accurate. And you can use this to set a spec and also make sure that you're not gonna have any microbial growth in your products. So as long as you're below a water activity of 0.65 or 0.6, then you know that no microorganisms can grow in that sample or in that product. And this is something that I'll talk about more today in my presentation. For this device, something else that makes it really stand out above moisture content is that it comes with standards. So these are salt solutions that we produce that we know with a really high degree of certainty what their water activity is. And so you can use these to check your device and make sure that the calibration is verified. So a lot of companies will use this maybe every shift or every 50 samples or so. Do you know how often you guys check yours?
Shift.
Yeah, and that's really common because you want to make sure that your device is within spec and that you're getting the readings that you should be. We recommend a protocol called bracketing. So if your product is at 0.6 water activity, then you'd want to use a 0.5 and a 0.76 standard. So basically just going on each side of that product. When it comes to putting a sample in this device, like if I was gonna prep this sample, then I just wanna make sure to cut it up and expose the inside. This allows it to come to equilibrium faster and make sure that we get an accurate reading. You don't want to take this and grind it up though. Sometimes I'll see companies do this, maybe put it in a powdered form. And the reason you don't wanna do that is because anytime you introduce any heat to this, it's gonna automatically start to change the moisture and the water activity. So we wanna get a water activity that's representative of the final product itself. And then if I was to prep this and put it into one of these sample cups, I would want to quickly do that because if you allow this to sit out in the environment, it automatically starts to come to equilibrium with the environment around us. So if the humidity in here was, let's say 30%, that means that this product will eventually try to come to a 0.3 water activity. So water activity is equal to relative humidity, and this is constantly trying to come to equilibrium, but we can prevent that or slow it by choosing the correct packaging for it. And I'll talk about that more today in my presentation as well. So you would just prep the sample, put it in here, maybe 3 to 5 minutes, and you would get a reading, and then you can move on to the next sample. Part of what Tony talked about earlier is wanting to digitize records. So our newer devices than this one will actually automatically record that reading and put it in the cloud for you so that you don't have to write anything down. So the advantage of that is if you have an inspector come in or if you have a problem in your facility, then it's really easy to go back and look at your records and see exactly when something was out of spec. We can also have a new setting or a setting on our new device that allows you to, you know, the screen will turn red if something's out of spec, or you can even require people to run standards before they can even run a sample. So you can put in some safeguards that even help your process even further. So I'll stop there for a second. Are there any questions about this device or water activity in general?
Are there any restrictions in terms of products that may not work?
Yeah, so the biggest restriction is that if you have any product that contains volatile components, so if there is propylene glycol in there or ethanol or something like that, then this type of sensor wouldn't be the best one. We make a different one called a TDL, a tunable diode laser, which basically uses a laser and scans for an isotope of water. So if we work with companies that measure water activity of gasoline, for example, they have to use that method. The dew point sensor that's in here does a pretty good job, though, otherwise. So in some extreme cases, you may need a different type of technology. So this device is really unique because we can look at a really wide range of temperatures. So 15 to 50 degrees Celsius, you can take a reading. But whatever temperature you set this device at, you want to make sure that the product is within about 2 degrees of that set temperature. If not, we make a separate equilibration plate. So you just take your sample and put it on that plate first to bring it to temperature, and then you would put it in here to read. So you wouldn't want to put a hot sample in here because then you're going to get condensation on the mirror that's in here, and that would cause a false reading. So you just want to make sure it's close to the temperature that you set. Did you have a question?
Is it just measure free water?
Yeah, basically it's measuring water activity, which you can think of as free water or unbound water. So it's water that's available for chemical reactions or microbial growth or physical changes. I hear it expressed like that a lot, and I'll talk about this a little later too, but a better definition of water activity is water energy. It's actually a thermodynamic principle that's the energy of that water, and that energy can be used for microbial growth and other things. Let me see if I forgot anything. Yeah, here's a cleaning kit for it. So again, it's really important just to stay on top of the cleaning of these devices. Basically, it's a three-step method. You clean with isopropyl alcohol or the cleaning solution that's in here. Then you clean with distilled water and then a dry Kim wipe. If you're ever cleaning one of these things, you just want to be careful like around the fan and just take your time. Again, you probably want to clean it like every shift or just set a protocol for how often you stay on top of cleaning. And then we do recommend like an annual calibration service. So every year this device is sent to us and we check it out. If we've upgraded anything, those upgrades automatically come with it. The newest device that we have, instead of having to send in the entire device, you just remove the sensor block and send that to us. So it's a lot easier with some of our newer devices. So we can actually just swap a sensor block to keep companies up and running instead of having to send this and then maybe send a loaner device and go through all of those steps.
So
the AQUALAB 3 is the device that does that method.
Is that new?
It's fairly new, I think maybe 2 years now. The AQUALAB 3, the only disadvantage is that it only runs at room temperature, so at 25 degrees Celsius, which is most often what you do. This one can measure at a wider range, like we were saying. So if you wanted to do a temperature abuse study or maybe a shelf life study, something like this would be better. This is generally used more as an R&D tool, whereas that AQUALAB 3 is more of a quality or in-process tool. So today during my presentation, we'll talk a lot about water activity. I'm going to talk about how it relates to shelf life and packaging. I'll talk about how it relates to yield and revenue. If you use water activity instead of moisture content or to complement moisture content, you can increase your average moisture content. And this can have a huge impact on yield and revenue. So we'll look at some of those numbers. And then water activity can also be used with something called an isotherm, which is kind of like a moisture map. And that can be used to really speed up formulation processes. So we'll go over all of that later today.